next session on modern attacks on AI with the afternoon blues challenge provided to Mr. Vinod Senthil, Director and Chief Technical Officer, infySEC Solution Private Limited. He grew up as a computer nerd throughout his life. He loves hardcore gaming, network and security. He has many passions, few of them are computer gaming, teaching, playing with his doggy, chatting and doing little photography, beatboxing, brain hacking, music, traveling. And outside, he's obsessed with trekking, cycling, hiking, skating, and basically anything that gives him excuse to be outside. He is also author of www.dowebscan.com. He loves family, friends, and himself more than anything else.
Good afternoon, all. Good afternoon. Excellent. So I know it's very hard to be awake after lunch. So I promise you there won't be a lot of talking. There'll be more of videos to keep it a little more interactive. Yes? So taking it forward. Oops, it says thank you. Okay, so 2018-2020, AI-powered cyber attacks, right? AI-powered cyber attacks. So I come from a penetration testing and vulnerability assessment background, so my point of view will always be from how offensive can the technology become, right? And also see what are the methods possibly where we could defend it. Yes? Okay. A quick intro about me. I'm Vinod Senthil, founder CTO of infySEC. My qualifications are BE Computer Science. Also done my PGDBA IT and HR. And I also got the opportunity to do diploma in cyber law from Mr. Shankaran sir, who's available here. I also have Mr. Rama sir, under whom I actually did my CISSP. I'm fortunate to be guided by both of them, right? And I also possess few of the technical certification, which includes this. Approximately, I have close to over 17 certifications. And now I've stopped doing any certifications for information, yeah? Okay, how do I define the world's most secured system, right? If you ask me to define the world's most secured system, I would define it this way. The world's most secured system is a system that is dug 10,000 miles underground, surrounded by 10,000 volts of electrified fences, filled with toxic nitrous gases on all sides, with a bunch of trained army men to secure it. It also stays to be one of the most vulnerable systems on the internet, right? I'm sure most of you might not agree to it, right? But like what the previous speaker said, there are two types of people in the whole world, just two types of people. Number one, people who know they are hacked. Two, people who do not know they are hacked. What does it mean? It means apparently all of us are compromised already. Yep. Okay, let me ask you this. How many of you here use Google? Please raise your hands. Both hands, yeah. Right? So there's a very interesting saying. They say 75% of the internet users, I repeat, 75% of the internet users today use Google to search. Right? I'm not complete with the statement. Right? 75% of the internet users use Google to search. Rest, 25% of them use Google to check if their internet is working properly. Yes or no? Right? So we are so dependent on Google. So a quick question. How many of you, can you name me five Google products? Five products, any five products of Google? Gmail? Google? Duo? Apps? Google Pay? Android? Excellent. Now tell me this, Android. It's a mobile operating system. So Google exactly knows where you're standing right now using the GPS coordinates, yes or no? Excellent. Google Pay. Google knows your credit or debit card detail. Google Tess. Now Google Pay, yes or no? Very interesting. And Google Chat. Chat actually, Google Hangouts. They actually know who you chat with, who your friends are. Google had something called Orkut, now Hangouts. They know who your friends are, their birth dates, their anniversary dates, etc. And they can also recognize them by their faces. Yes or no? So something very interesting. It says the EULA license, right? So, okay, how many of us, I mean, I asked you five products and it was very instant that you answered me the five products. Yes or no? Right? But tell me this, Do you have different username and password for all of these products? No. Say someone asks your mama or your dad asks your Gmail account's password, right? What would you do? You share it. It simply means that you're also sharing your credit card details to them. Yes or no? Excellent. EULA license, end user's license agreement. That is one of the most least used agreement that we usually use, right? Whenever there's a dialog box on your computer, you just say next, 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 okay. Yes or no? Are you sure you want to install this virus? Next. Are you sure you want to format drive? Okay. You know, we just don't care about what's written. In fact, if you create a Google account, point number 18, 19, and 21 clearly tells that they're allowed to do anything with the data that they get from us. And we say, I agree. Yes, I got a forward message in the morning. It says, very interesting forward message. It says, arguing with your wife. Right? EULA license is like arguing with your wife. Whatever it is, end of it, you click, I agree. Yes or no? Right? So, I saw a very interesting advertisement which read like this. It says, Google, now hiring. No need to apply. We have all your information. Wow. I think this is atrocity of AI, isn't it? Okay. Now tell me the basic question. I go back to the basics. What makes us humans, right? Us different? What makes us different from the food chain or the all the cycles? What we have that one sense, which is the fifth or the fourth or the sixth sense. Sixth sense that makes all the difference, right? Sight, touch, hearing, taste, and smell is all that most of the animals also have, right? What makes us different from rest of them? Sorry? Intelligence? Yes? Okay, interesting. Look at this. Technology becomes our sixth sense. You have Google Glass, you have smart chip, you have a smartphone, you have smart socks, you have a smart shoe, you have smart health meters, right? So you're already sharing a lot of information about you to a system that you do not know, right? Okay, I'm just sharing a very interesting video. I want you all to pay attention. So it's going to be a mix and match of a lot of videos here, right?
Peggy 18.
In the summer of 2003, the lights went out for 55 million Americans across the Northeast. Panic spread throughout New York State, injuring hundreds. 11 people died in the dark. What was to blame? A small vulnerability inside the state's transmission control room. Raymond Kenny, a disgruntled employee, unleashed a virus and walked away. 4 hours later, the system overloaded and the grid shut down. 10 years on, modern systems have advanced exponentially. 2011 marked the installation of America's first central operating system. CTOS is a computer software that manages entire cities, providing centralized control over subway lines, traffic lights, surveillance cameras, and electricity grids. A computer now controls a major city, but who controls the computer? The answer is private companies that have everything to gain from a CTOS. Personal data collection is the key commodity. You are no longer an individual. You are a data cluster bound to a vast global network. Last year, the average American cast a digital shadow of over 2.3 gigabytes. What does that represent? Of course, there are credit cards, medical records, and reading habits, but a CTOS includes much more. Massive data silos track and sort every moment of your digital life, revealing how you think and what you believe. That information could be turned against you, not just to sell products, but to influence your worldviews. CTOS directly links your personal information to the physical systems you use every day, essentially providing a direct line to your bedroom laptop. Because all data is interconnected, from Nigerian email scams to hardcore pornography, online shopping to emergency services, it's all part of the same network. 10 years ago, one man shut down the entire Northeast from a central control room. Today, everything can be hacked. No one knows what part of the system will be exploited, but everyone agrees the next assault will do more than just turn out the lights.
Excellent. So I just played this video for you to understand we are already in a very... Right? We are already in a very digitally connected world, right? Please pay attention to another very interesting video that I'm going to play. This is about something called the RoboCop. How many of you heard of RoboCop? No, RoboCop. RoboCop, right? So please pay attention. It's a remarkable achievement in terms of AI, right? Let's see what it is.
According to artificial intelligence boffins, the world is readying itself for robot football. Dr. Ian Pearson, a cybernetics engineer, claims that in just 28 years' time, robots will be able to run faster, dribble better, and shoot harder than any professional footballer ever achieved.
In the 21st century, a player will rise like no other. It will feel no pity, no remorse, no guilt.
So, pretty much just like footballers are now then?
Yeah, but it will have one purpose. To return to the past and change the future.
Listen, understand, it's out there. It can't be reasoned with, it can't be bargained with. It's going to score goals, and you cannot stop it.
Acrobatic overhead kick. Sprint past Casillas. The goalkeeper, no chance at all.
Okay, so this was a quick video that talks about RoboCup. RoboCup is nothing but a soccer game that is played against, an ambitious soccer game that's played against humans and robots, humanoids, right? And it is expected that the coordination in robots are always better than humans. Yes or no? So there are high chances they would win, right? So scientists are very ambitious to get this project done, right, by 2020, right? Okay. Now I would like to show you something else in terms of AI and 3D printing space, right? Please pay attention to this very interesting video.
Now, following a story in the Washington Post that included a photo of the master keys, 3D printing enthusiasts have managed to duplicate some of the keys that open all those locks. The printer templates have now been uploaded to the internet, essentially making all those millions of locks worthless as a way to keep a determined thief with.
So I'm just skipping it here. So this actually is another threat where any image, any photo which has a key, right, key or a fingerprint, can be reprinted. When I say fingerprint, it also means that your biometrics can be compromised. They have this special layer of gelatin, all that kind of chemicals which can help you create a very finger-like material or something like this. An attacker can print a key looking at a photo of yours. How sweet is that? Right? Let's see a little further. Look at this. Another.
What Alfredo Orihuela has in his hands is something that wasn't supposed to be available. It's the parts for a 3D printed gun called the Liberator, one of the designs by Defense Distributed that was scheduled to be released online today until a judge blocked them with an emergency order. For weeks, lawmakers and pundits have been freaking out about a sudden stockpile of 3D guns.
This is about weapons of war being made in people's living rooms.
Critics are calling it downloadable death. What could possibly go wrong?
But as Orihuela's living room makes clear, the battle over 3D printed firearms has been over for years. Orihuela runs a 3D printing company out of his home. He sells printing machines like the one here to schools and maker studios, some for as little as components of gun control. The blueprints for the gun were online for only a few days.
Okay, so this is what I wanted to show, right? There are certain 3D printable models that are available for download today, right? When you're talking about graphic companies working on models, 3D models, right? These 3D models could be 3D printed, right? And you could give some mechanical adjustments to it so it actually gets into life. You understand what I'm saying, right? So this is something that I was really worried about, you know, someone printing a gun from their living room, right? And I'll tell you, how many of you know of this website called the Pirate Bay? Most of you are aware, right? Pirate Bay is a very popular torrent website, right? And if you notice, in their categories, there is one category says movie, games, PC, softwares, all that stuff, right? There's one category which says Fissibles. No, what is Fissibles? Fissibles are nothing but 3D model which is downloadable. You can just download them and print it. You understand what I'm saying? Right? So I was very, intrigued into seeing all of these kind of news that I came across. Then I started to collect all of these, right? And interestingly, I read something that caught my attention, which happened last year, December, was in UK, right? There was a humanoid robot, right? Humanoid, which was used as a housemaid. You understand? So it usually washes, cleans the home, all that stuff. And interestingly, after a few months of it serving the owner, right, what it did is something that was I was not able to digest. That particular humanoid actually committed suicide. A humanoid committing suicide. And the worst part is it was found in the River Thames, right? It was droned, right? And there was a printout on the owner's house, on the table. It says that I'm unable to handle the pressure the humans are giving me by world. No, this really caught my attention, right? Look at this, very interesting one.
A brand new high-tech security robot named Steve was found dead Monday morning, floating lifelessly in an office tower fountain.
It's a great mashup of technology, of all the greatest things that are going on in Silicon Valley. It's robotics, it's sensors, autonomous technology, big data, predictive analytics. So it's a combination of looking at 360-degree daytime, nighttime video, thermal imaging. We can run 300 license plates a minute and run it against a national database.
This is a robot security.
Okay. Isn't this disturbing at all? No, any computer device is meant to follow certain protocol. There can be chances that it might learn certain stuff, or the algorithm is smart enough to learn certain stuff that override an existing protocol. They call it the protocol benders, right? Even in DNS protocol, there's something called the protocol bending, where there can be exceptions also. You understand what I'm saying? So how many of you like to see a quick demo of what I created on a web application? Anyone be interested? Yes? Excellent. So I'm just quickly opening up a popular bot that I created when I was in my college. This is how it looks like. Okay? This is how it looks like. So if any one of you want to ask any question, please ask me. I'll just type it for you. And for example, I say hi. It says, hello. I ask, how are you? It says, I'm fine, thanks. How are you? Now, I want someone to ask a question from here. Then I'll pass it here. Anyone from here? Will it rain tomorrow? Wow. Will it rain? It usually does, doesn't it? Okay, anyone from here? Let's make it a little more interactive here. What did you have for lunch today? What did you have for lunch today? Let's see. I require only Velamal, miss. I'm sorry, I was studying from Velamal Engineering College. All right, so what I did is I created this bot to mimic me, and there were a lot of friends of mine who were chatting with me all night. What does it mean? It means that if they were chatting with someone else. Something interesting is, there was one friend of mine who's called Raj Gautam. He kept chatting to me the next morning till he caught the bus, right? And he calls me, Macha, where are you? I said, I'm already in the college. He said, I'm chatting with you. right? Something very interesting about these kind of bots is I wrote this in a language called AIML. This was 7.5 to 8 years ago, right? Artificial intelligence markup language. And interestingly, something very interesting about these kind of AI-based languages, the database or the knowledge base of this bot that I wrote, right, in the morning was 5 MB. In the later evening, it is 500 MB. And it automatically learns. You understand? From people, from chat, from Wikipedia, from Google, all that, based on whatever. You want to ask some other questions? Maybe we'll take 3 more questions. What's your age? Kathy, can you type, please? I'll just say, what is your age? There are 2 W's there. What is your age? Let's complete this question. I was connected to the net on December 15, 1984. That was my birthday for your information. Right? Okay, let's ask another question. What is that? Once again, what is? Yeah, what is AI? Artificial intelligence is a branch of engineering and science devoted to constructing machines that think. Are you testing me? Wow. Sorry? It is Air India. Oh, okay. Excellent. So anyone here? Oh, it is 7.5 years ago. He probably doesn't know. When is the next metro to airport? Anyone else? Fast. Let's be prepared for another question. What are you doing currently? What are you doing right now? Whatever. I'm too busy to invest time in such matters for your information. Yeah. What are you doing right now? What are you doing currently, whatever? He is competitor, so he'll not know. His enemy. At this moment, I'm just killing time. Right? Oh. I think I should have avoided that question. Who is your girlfriend? Answering you. Yeah, I'm sorry, what is the other question? What is the future of robotics? You are talking to her. You're talking to her. By the way, this bot is considered to be a she and not a he, right? And still I was mimicking myself as this robot, right? So I'll just... Thanks, Karthik. I'll just call you back again. So this was a quick demo. How many of you like this demo? Right? Okay. If you think this is a killer technology, I want to say that this was done by me 8 years ago. Right? Look at what Chinese have for us.
首先要解决就是在一幅场景里边或者图像上去找到人脸在什么地方，我们要对这个人脸呢进行关键点的定位，我们需要定位出他的眼角、以及鼻尖、鼻翼和嘴角。描述完了以后呢，我们要去到库里边去做人脸的比对。
This is again to mix with the behavioral pattern analysis as well. Yeah? So let me go to the next. Okay. I'm actually a little concerned about what is happening today. The era that we are right now in. Look at this very interesting article that I read. Right? It was a news article. And I want you to read from here. It says, a couple of government-funded tech guys were able to hack into and take control of a car's steering, dashboard, and brakes. Right? Today, I would like to reiterate, today the cars that we are driving today are not automobiles anymore. I repeat, the cars that we are driving today are not automobiles anymore. They are computers with extended steering, dashboard, and brakes. Right? I'll tell you something very interesting that happened in this year, January 2018 in UK, again in UK, right? You are aware of these autonomous cars, right? People sit inside the car and say, hey, please navigate me to Tinagar, navigate me to this place, that place, yes? It automatically plots a map on the Google Maps or something, then uses the sensors in the car and starts to move. Yes or no, right? I'll tell you what happened. You all are aware of what a ransomware attack is. Right, ransomware attack is a way in which an attacker tries to encrypt your own confidential file, and if you want to open them, he asks for a ransom. See, for opening your own file, you have to pay someone. Right? That's called the ransomware attack, right? So a similar ransomware attack actually infected a car, an autonomous car, a driverless, self-driving autonomous car. Right? Imagine this exactly happened there. There's a victim who sits in the car and says, hey, take me to Piccadilly Circus. Right? He sits in the car. It plots a graph and actually the car starts to move. Right? Once the car is moving, it got compromised through some artificial intelligence based worm or a virus. Right? What happened is, say in a four-way track, all the cars are going this way. Right? There is one car that's coming in the opposite direction. Right? And the car parks itself in the center of a very busy road with the doors and windows locked. Right? The person inside the car is unable to get down now. There's a message on the display of the car. Right? It pops up a message. It says, right, if you want to get down of the car, pay a ransom of 0.3 bitcoins. Right? It sounds like some English movie, isn't it? Something very interesting about this is how an attacker can actually influence an AI system, right? See, it's an algorithm. If you corrupt a bit, immediately you can corrupt the whole thing. Yes or no? Right? That's something that you have to be very careful about. Look at this. The same thing.
WannaCry ransomware attack was the biggest ever. Could your car become the target of hackers? As if we don't have enough to worry about with cyber thieves hacking into social media, our emails, and other online accounts, a report published by the Government Accountability Office says there's a new target we've been overlooking, our cars. Though they make driving safer, the various computerized gadgets inside modern cars also provide ample ways for hackers to target vehicles. In fact, the more lines of code within a vehicle's software, the more vulnerable it is to cyber attacks. According to the U.S. Department of Transportation, a modern vehicle can contain as many as 100 million lines of software code, 15 times more than a Boeing 787 Dreamliner. A hacker could gain remote access by breaking into a car's Bluetooth, radio, and Wi-Fi systems. By doing so, the attacker could affect systems critical to driver and passenger safety, including the car's brakes and engine. Once these systems are compromised, it may affect the car's ability to maintain cruise control.
You get it? So I was actually reading something about these two visionaries, right? Mark Zuckerberg, the founder of Facebook, and Elon Musk, the founder of Tesla, PayPal, etc., right? And he's also the founder of something called the Deep AI, Deep Mind. Yes? He's one of the strongest open-sourced AI solutions that's available, right? Look at that. Mark Zuckerberg openly gave a comment about Elon Musk. He said, people who drum doomsday scenarios, I actually think it is pretty irresponsible. This is what Mark Zuckerberg said about Elon Musk, right? Because Elon Musk said that there are high chances it might go wrong, right? And then Elon commented about his statement, right? He said, I've talked to Mark about this. His understanding on the subject is very limited. Wow, I was just amazed. Look at that. He also put that on a tweet here. He just said that on a public tweet, right? Okay. Imagine any electronic system that has an IP could be compromised, which is connected could be compromised, right? In that case, artificial intelligence could actually take over the whole system. Yes or no, right? Let's see a quick video. I'm sure most of you would have seen this.
It's flying itself. Its processor can react 100 times faster than a human. Just like any mobile device these days, it has cameras and sensors. It does facial recognition. Inside here is 3 grams of shaped explosive. This is how it works. That little bang is enough to penetrate the skull and destroy the contents. It's one of a range of products. Trained as a team, they can penetrate buildings, cars, trains, evade people, bullets, pretty much any countermeasure. They cannot be stopped. Now, I said this was big. Why? Because we are thinking big. Watch. A $25 million order now buys this. Enough to kill half a city, the bad half. Nuclear is obsolete. Take out your entire enemy, virtually risk-free. Just clients.
Okay, this was a mock video that I saw on the internet, but I feel that there are high chances something like this could happen in the future, right? Okay. Then I read about something called the beehive attack, very popular attack called the beehive attack, where most of you would have heard about this term called the cross-compiling, right? I'm a C programmer, right? But my program has a part of Java inside that, a part of C++ inside that, part of Ruby on Rails in that, right? In that case, what I do is, I'll do something called the cross-compiling. Once I compile the C, it'll probably call a function on C++, then it'll loop to Java, etc., to execute a massive task. You understand? So beehive attack is a technique where an artificial intelligence system understands programming languages, right? And whenever it finds areas that it is unable to do a certain task, it will find a countermeasure for that. For example, disabling a firewall, writing program to disable a firewall, writing a program to install a Trojan, writing a, or changing a password without even asking. Right? If it finds an antivirus is something that would stop it, it'll disable that. You understand what I'm saying? So this is a very interesting attack, and this is other sides of AI, right? And I read about this. It says Air Hopper hacking into an isolated computer using FM radio signal. Oof. What is the last thing that we can do? We would probably pull the system off the internet. Yes or no? And I think even that is not safe. Right? The popular attacks, Air Hopper hacking into an isolated computer using FM radio signals, right? Okay, and I have the last two slides here. This is Mr. Bruce Nir. He's otherwise called the father of cryptography. And he clearly says that if you think technology can solve your security problems, I repeat, if you think technology can solve your security problems, then you don't understand the problem and you don't understand the technology. Why? Say there is an application which has a vulnerability, say SQL injection vulnerability. You should write validation and fix the vulnerability. You should just not put a web application firewall before it to prevent it. That's not the fix. You understand what I'm saying? Right? Okay. And to me, I always believe in this. 100 men can be replaced by one ordinary computer. But even 100 computers cannot replace one extraordinary man. Yes or no? Right? And it is high time we all equip ourselves, right? And become one of those extraordinary men. You know, even though if not extraordinary, we should be at least on par with the industry, right? We should be on par with the technology. We should know what to share, what not to share. When there is an application that's asking you to allow access to everything, you should think about it. You should have that logical acumen to do it. You understand what I'm saying, right? So I think awareness is the key. And if we have another 5 minutes, I can show you a quick demo. Do we have five? I'm sorry, sir, do we have? I'm sorry? Okay, we have 1.5 minutes. Okay, so I have a particular device that we created in our garage. Okay, this is a device, and for which I need actually 2 volunteers. Right? So what this is going to do is, it would try to read the brain signals for one person who moves their hand, right, and transmits it to the other person. So the other person's hand actually moves. Yeah, something like that. Yeah? You would be interested? Who'd be interested to volunteer? You already came there. Please do. Okay, one person here. Yeah, hi Balaji. And one more person, yeah? Okay, so please come here. Your name is? Mehul, all right. So I'd request Karthik. Karthik is one of my other directors of my company, so I'm requesting him to help me out with this. This one for Mehul. We'll try to make it as soon as possible. Don't worry, we are not killing time here. We didn't know how to monetize that. You can do it for him. Here? This way. This is what I'm doing, and I call you the fucker. Let's see how much it works. Okay. Okay, let's try this out. Okay, can we switch off this projector, please? Right. So what I'm going to do is, I actually have connected 2 set of electrodes from his hand, connected to his hand, right? And I want him to move his hands like this. Maybe connect it this way, from here. In this element. Let's try this out. Not sure how it will work. Okay. Now, you're Mehul, right?
Yeah.
And you're? Balaji, right? What I'm going to ask, request Mehul is, I want him to move his hand like this, strong, like you do the biceps exercise now, right? Are you doing it hard?
Yeah.
Do it slowly, like this. Yes? Okay, do you feel anything?
So far,
no. No? Okay. Now, what I'm going to do is, I'm just going to tell you this, in brains there are 3 parts, right? Cerebrum, cerebellum, and medulla. This part is actually the cerebrum cortex, right? That actually passes through the lumbar nerve. What I'm doing is I'm actually connecting these electrodes on the lumbar nerve. You understand what I'm saying? And just trying to do something here. If you feel something, please let me know. You keep doing that. Do you find something? Do you feel a little pinch?
I surely feel the pain.
I'm sorry? Here's a stronger forearm. I've been doing some kind of research, so this has happened to be one of them. So, oh, I'm sorry. I did not switch it on. Okay. Okay, now I see the lights glowing.
Okay, please let me know if you find some change. Yeah?
Yeah, I can.
Okay. So, no, no, be slow. When I say you'll do, right? Okay. Wow. Slowly, slowly. Look at this. Okay, hold on. Now, try avoiding to move it.
Okay.
Hold it hard. Let's see what happens. I asked you to avoid doing it.
It's going much faster.
Excellent. So I'll just stop it here. Thank you for being an excellent sport. What we try to do is actually read from something, some human body, and try to inject it elsewhere, right? So I'm sure there are a lot of worms and artificial intelligence based attack that would come to do all this automatic, right? So I would also say the best part in one's life is doing what people say you cannot do, right? Think like an attacker before he hacks you, right? Thank you very much. Thank you very much.
Thank you. I think this can be used during appraisal period to connect with manager. Okay, thank you, Senthil. Now I invite Natarajan Swaminathan from TCS to hand over the memento to Senthil. Please check your voting pads. Thank you.